Today we are going to look at the evolution which took place in the field of public administration over a number of decades. So we are going to talk about the new public administration and the concept of new public management. Of course, before that, we look at what we talked about during the last lesson. We compared public and private administration, their characteristics, their similarities, and their differences during the last lecture. हमने पिछले लेक्चर में ये कोशिश की थी कि पब्लिक और प्राइवेट एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन में जो मुश्तरका चीज़ें हैं या जो मुख्तलिफ चीज़ें हैं उनका जायजा लिया जाए. एंड वी फाउंड दैट द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट डिफरेंसेस वर दैट पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन वाज पॉलिटिकली डायरेक्टेड वेयर एज देयर इज नो सच थिंग इन प्राइवेट एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन. पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन में जो कुछ होता है वो सियासत के मुताबिक होता है कि सियासतदान जो इलेक्ट होके आया है और जो वादे उसने किए हुए हैं अपने कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट से उनके मुताबिक वो डायरेक्शन देता है कि जी ये पॉलिसीज हैं, ये प्रोग्राम्स हैं, इनको पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ने इम्प्लीमेंट करना है. लेकिन जहां तक प्राइवेट एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन का तल्लुक है वहां पर कोई पॉलिटिकल कंटेंट नहीं होता, वहां पे सिंपली प्रॉफिट मैक्सिमाइजेशन का कॉन्सेप्ट होता है. हर ओनर जो बिजनेस ऑर्गेनाइजेशन का है वो ये चाहता है कि जिस हद तक प्रॉफिट बन सके वो बनाए. बहरहाल उसे कंपेटिटिव रहना पड़ता है कि कॉम्पिटेटिव रहते हुए वो अपने प्रॉफिट को मैक्सिमाइज करे. इसी तरह जरा प्राइवेट सेक्टर में एक्टिविटीज नैरो है, उनका स्कोप नैरो है, इसी तरह उनका इंपैक्ट भी इतना ज्यादा लोगों पे नहीं होता और कोई खास कंसिडरेशन उसमें नहीं करनी पड़ती सिवाय क्वालिटी के. ज्यादातर एम्फोसिस जो है प्राइवेट सेक्टर में क्वालिटी का होता है, लेकिन पब्लिक सेक्टर में एम्फोसिस बिल्कुल डिफरेंट हो जाता है. आपने आपका स्कोप बहुत बड़ा है, पूरा मुल्क है, आपने मैक्रो लेवल पे नेशनल लेवल पे पॉलिसीज और प्रोग्राम्स देने, आपने फिर उनके इंपैक्ट का भी ख्याल रखना है क्योंकि उन्होंने पूरी पॉपुलेशन को असरअंदाज करना है. तो अगर कोई अनटूवर्ड इंपैक्ट होता है उसका रिएक्शन भी आता है. सो यू हैव टू बी वेरी कंसिडरेट about what you are doing and you have to be considerate about all the stratas of the society. You have to treat everyone uniformly. You have to take special care of certain groups, the vulnerable, the poor. These are special groups. So these considerations come into public administration. But private administration is not concerned. They have the same price for the product for a poor or a rich person. They may have different kinds of products for them, but for the same product, it will be the same price. Then very important, public accountability. Public sector mein accountability ka bahut important role hai. We see कि आजकल मीडिया हैज बिकम a big source of public accountability. और उसके अलावा पब्लिक के बिहाफ पे गवर्नमेंट की भी कई ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस होती हैं जो हर अदारे को अकाउंटेबल रखने की कोशिश करती हैं. और उसमें हमने देखा है कि जहां तक फाइनेंशियल अकाउंटेबिलिटी का तल्लक है, हमारा बहुत बड़ा एक सेटअप है फाइनेंस डिवीजन का और ऑडिटर जनरल का, और ये एग्जिस्ट करता है तकरीबन तमाम कंट्रीज में, जो इंश्योर करता है कि फाइनेंशियल डिसिप्लिन एक्सरसाइज किया जा रहा है हर पब्लिक सेक्टर के अदारे में और वेस्ट नहीं हो रहा. इकोनॉमी है, एफिशिएंसी है, वैल्यू फॉर मनी है, इंश्योर की जा रही है. लेकिन ये कंसिडरेशंस जो हैं डू नॉट फीचर इनटू द प्राइवेट सेक्टर बिकॉज द मनी बिलोंग्स टू द मैनेजर or the owner, and they can use it the way they like, the way they think is best for them. They are not accountable to anyone unless it is a organization which is floated on the stock exchange and the shareholders have some say over how you are managing the finances. And then we saw that the principle of uniformity is very important. You have to ensure equal treatment for everyone. And everything has to be according to law, within a legal framework, and uniform application of that law to everyone, irrespective of their background or standing. Later we looked at the similarities between the public and the private sector and found that as long as the organizational aspects are concerned, they are almost the same. You got to have the same kind of functions, the finance function, the accounting function, the human resource function, and you may use the same kind of techniques to motivate and motivate people or your workers. So from the organizational point of view, there are many similarities and some well-known thinkers of the discipline of public administration feel that we should not really highlight too much on the differences because basically both are organizations, whether it be a public sector or a private sector organization, and we should follow the principles of efficient functioning of an organization in both the cases. And then we looked at the market versus state debate. Should the market be the regulator or should the state be the regulator? And we found that market should be the regulator according to current viewpoint, and also state may step in where there is a failure of the market, and it should step in promptly then and in a very transparent manner. So a balanced view of the state, role of the state, is necessary when we are comparing private and public administration to ensure that state does not dampen the private spirit, state does not interfere unnecessarily in the affairs of the private sector, and state does not distort the market economy. Now, looking at the concept of new public administration, this first started with a conference called the First Minnowbrook Conference, held in the United States, and it was led by Dwight Waldo, a well-known name in the discipline of public administration. It criticized the concept of public administration, traditional public administration, and came up with certain themes, feeling that these were not being emphasized as public administration stood at that time. The themes were of social equity, that were the actions of the public administrators in keeping with social equity? Was there an equitable distribution of the benefits of growth through public administration? And ethics. How ethical were we in dealing with the public and in dealing with the businesses? Ethics was highlighted as very necessary in the bureaucratic setup, because without that, the quality of services would become unethical and not up to the mark. It would be tainted by unethical underpinnings. It also emphasized on the human relations aspect, that the new public administration should go out of the way and behave in a more humanistic way with its clients, and not remain just behind four walls without any feedback from those whom it intends to serve. The accountability issue was also emphasized in this conference, and the concept of administrative leadership was also highlighted. Administrative leadership is extremely important if you want change and movement away from status quo orientation in a bureaucratic organization. So this was underlined. And another thing, how do we reconcile public administration with democracy? This takes us back to the administrative political dichotomy. How does the elected representative interact with the bureaucrat or the administrator? At the end of the day, is it the elected person who's prevailing, or is it the technical and more professionally sound and exposed bureaucrat who prevails as far as policy making or decision making or implementation of policy is concerned? The goals which were highlighted for the new public administration were that it should be relevant. Efficiency is okay, you should be efficient. But the real test would lie in your relevance to having been able to address the issues of the people in a proper manner. Then it also stated that the typical stance taken by bureaucracy, that we are neutral, we are value-free, it is false. You are actually serving some values, so why not be open about it? That bureaucrats should, public administration should come out openly and state, or let it be known, what values they stand for or what they are serving. And then the poor and the underprivileged should get their share. Back to social equity. This should be one of the major goals and objectives of the new public administration. extremely important. Client focus. Mere emphasis on organizational performance was not sufficient. Okay, you got a very good organization. Aapne bahut zabardast ek public sector ki organization bana liye. Uske zabardast daftar hain, log bhi professional hain, baithe hue hain. Kaam chal raha hai aur wo ye keh rahe hain ki hum har cheez sahi kar rahe hain. Hamare operations mein efficiency hai. Humne itne paise mein itna bada daftar bana liya. Humne ye kar diya. Lekin kya wo kaafi hai? Are they in touch with their clients? They are doing what they think should be done. But are they in touch with their clients? Do the people who need their services, whom they are serving, have a voice in what is happening? That what should be the quality of the service? When do they need it? Where do they need it? In what form do they need it? So the exact needs of the people being served need to be addressed, and they have to be known before being addressed. Unfortunately, as we know, that bureaucrats generally are not in touch with the realities and with the people whom they are supposed to serve. So this was highlighted that client focus is a must. और वो जो एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव लीडरशिप की बात हुई थी कि आपको किस किस्म का लीडर चाहिए न्यू पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन को आगे लेके जाने के लिए आगे चलाने के लिए यू नीड अ पर्सन विद अ पॉजिटिव माइंडसेट नॉट अ नेगेटिव एटीट्यूड बट अ पॉजिटिव एटीट्यूड एंड ही शुड नॉट वेट फॉर थिंग्स टू हैपन एंड देन रिएक्ट ही शुड बी प्रोएक्टिव दिस लीडर should be proactive and take action before something negative happens. And he should be responsive. And this ties up again with the needs of the people. Ke responsiveness to tabhi hogi agar aapko pata hoga ke logon ko kya chahiye ya aap jo service logon ko provide kar rahe hain uske bare mein logon ka kya taasur hai. और अगर आपको ये पता लग गया है तो फिर आपने इमीडिएटली रिस्पॉन्ड करना है इन कीपिंग विद द डिजायर्स ऑफ द क्लाइंट सो द काइंड ऑफ लीडरशिप एनविसेज्ड अंडर द न्यू पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन वाज टू बी वेरी डायनामिक पॉजिटिव प्रोएक्टिव एंड रिस्पॉन्सिव नाउ द पर्सपेक्टिव्स ऑफ दिस new paradigm shift. We can call this a paradigm shift in the theory of public administration and in the practice of public administration. So now there was this movement towards a normative theory, not a valueless or a value-free theory, with social concern and activism. कि आप सोसाइटी का कंसर्न लेके चलेंगे और आप बड़ा एक्टिवली लेके चलेंगे उसको आप समझेंगे सोसाइटी को सोशल कंसर्न्स आप रजिस्टर करेंगे और एक्टिवली आप उनको एड्रेस करेंगे इट मूव्ड अवे फ्रॉम पॉजिटिविज्म एंड साइंटिसिज्म यानी सिर्फ थ्योरियां बना लेना और साइंटिफिक थ्योरी इंट्रोड्यूस कर देना और सिर्फ कहना के लिए हर चीज न्यूट्रल है हर चीज पॉजिटिव है सब सही हो रहा है वो नहीं चलेगा सो दिस न्यू पर्सपेक्टिव वाज टू मूव अवे फ्रॉम दीज फॉल्स फसाड्स दिस न्यू कॉन्सेप्ट वाज लेस जेनेरिक एंड मोर प्रिस्क्रिप्टिव इसमें यह था कि आपने एक्शन करना है बातों से ज्यादा जनरलाइजेशन से ज्यादा ऑर्गेनाइजेशन पर तवज्जो देने से ज्यादा आपका एक्शन काउंट करेगा सो बी प्रिस्क्रिप्टिव कि ये मसला है इसका ये हल है हम करने लगे एंड देन bring in representative bureaucracy. The bureaucracy should know the people, their needs. A bureaucracy can only be representative if it is working at the grassroots and has that kind of experience and has been in touch with the people. और इसकी दूसरी जो एस्पेक्ट है वो ये है कि आप लोगों को एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन में शामिल करें. There should be a good participation, a valuable participation, a necessary participation of the people in all administrative processes. अगर आप लोगों को शामिल करते हैं एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव प्रोसेसेस में तो रिजल्ट्स बेहतर होंगे. इसमें कम्युनिटी पुलिसिंग का जो कॉन्सेप्ट है वो बहुत अच्छा एग्जांपल है कि आपने लोगों को इन्वॉल्व किया, पार्टिसिपेट करवाया, आपके अपने रिसोर्सेस कुछ बच गए, आपने रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी दी, आपने टेक्निकल नो हाउ दी, आपने सपोर्ट दी और एक कम्युनिटी में कम्युनिटी पॉलिसिंग शुरू हो गई. तो व्हेन वी गेट पीपल्स पार्टिसिपेशन इन एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव प्रोसेसेस, इट मेक्स लाइफ इजियर बोथ फॉर द एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर एंड द पीपल हु आर इन्वॉल्व्ड. अब इसका क्रिटिसिज्म आ गया, उनका जी ये तो पॉजिटिविस्ट नहीं है, ऐसी जो बातें कर रहे हैं, वो थ्योरी का भी कोई लिहाज नहीं कर रहे और मैनेजमेंट को डाइल्यूट कर रहे हैं कि जी पार्टिसिपेशन होनी चाहिए और हायरार्की इंपॉर्टेंट नहीं है इतनी ज्यादा, ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इतनी ज्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट नहीं है. दिस वाज वन ऑफ द क्रिटिसिज्म्स लेविड. और उन्होंने कहा, क्रिटिक्स ने, कि क्या आप सोशल इक्विटी को एक्चुअली एक ऑब्जेक्टिव बना सकते हैं या समझ सकते हैं पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन का? इज इट करेक्ट टू ब्रिंग इन सोशल इक्विटी इन टू द डिसिप्लिन ऑफ पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन? क्या यह होना चाहिए? सो व्हेन ऑल दीज क्वेश्चंस वर रेज्ड, दे कंक्लूडेड द क्रिटिक्स that this is only an illusion of a paradigm shift. Actually, there is no paradigm shift. It is just adding on a little bit to what was already happening. There is no real change that has been advocated in the concept of the new public administration. लेकिन इसका इंपैक्ट क्या हुआ या सिग्निफिकेंस क्या है? ये जो नई बातें आई, इन्होंने पॉलिसी फॉर्मुलेशन का, पॉलिसी इंप्लीमेंटेशन का जो एस्पेक्ट था उसको और स्ट्रेंथन कर दिया और साइंटिफिक बनाने की कोशिश की. और फिर जो एस्टैब्लिश्ड एक प्रिंसिपल था कि politician should look after politics only and administration should be free to do its own work without much interference from the politician, usko bhi challenge kiya ke nahi, everything has to be representative and hence political. So the age old politics administration dichotomy was challenged. That we can't separate the two. It also intensified ecological orientation, activism, and commitment of public administration community. When it brought in more stakeholders and in a more systematic manner, like involving the public itself, it became more of an ecological perspective. It went a step further than the ecological approach. And also, the activism and commitment of public administration community grew. They said, yes, we have to be more active. So there was a pressure on the public sector community to be active. And according to some, this pushed the discipline of public administration towards greater relevance for the common man and for the society at large. This also made the practitioners of public administration and the theorists and the academics to network with each other, because they got a platform at Minnowbrook Conference to exchange views and brought them closer, and more understanding of each other's viewpoint developed. It naturally tried to strengthen the client orientation in administration. And it supported the movement of democratic humanism. In other words, be democratic. Let democracy influence public administration. And be very, very much humanistic in your approach towards the clients whom you are supposed to serve. And it also, as a byproduct, promoted the awareness for the requirement of internal democracy within the system. So this new theory, this new paradigm shift, had a lot of significance for the development of the discipline of public administration. After a couple of decades, there was another Minnowbrook conference, which is called Minnowbrook II. Now, it emphasized some more themes. It emphasized leadership. It emphasized the constitutional and the legal perspective much more. When we say that everything in public administration has to be in accordance with law, this aspect was very much pushed to the forefront. Then it assessed the impact of technology, because technology was changing fairly fast at that time, on public administration, and how it could be integrated further to promote efficiency. It also looked afresh at the policy making issues and the policy implementation issues. Aur aakhir mein isme economic aspect jo tha usko bhi bahut highlight kiya gaya ki public administration kaise contribute karti hai, kyun kar contribute karti hai economic growth ki taraf aur economic development kitni important hai, khaas taur pe jab aap developing countries ki baat karte hain. So a new concept emerged, another paradigm shift. Now that is called the new public management. And this happened in the 1990s. This was inspired by David Osborne and Ted Gebler's publication called Reinventing Government. However, the term of new public management had already been coined by Christopher Hood in an article he wrote in 1991. And during the 90s, we have these great, two great big examples of the practice of new public management, and that is what is called Thatcherism and Reaganism. Both Thatcher and Reagan, Margaret Thatcher, who was also known as the Iron Lady, and Reagan, the actor turned president of US, implemented a lot of concepts which were thrown up in new public management. We see, for example, a lot of privatization taking place under Margaret Thatcher in the UK of 1990s, and a lot of private sector coming in the US, doing what used to be traditional public administration jobs during the 1990s. Again, we looked at this concept in when we were analyzing the concept of public administration vis-a-vis private administration, that market, not state, to be the key regulator of economy. This was the first cornerstone of the paradigm shift. Let the market regulate, not the state. And the state should shift from providing direct services to indirect methods, not provide services itself. Khud state na provide kare services, balki aisi policy banaye, is tarike se facilitate kare ke dusri entities wohi services provide kar sake, unko facilitate kare, ya contract out kar de kuch jobs ko, kuch service provision ko, aur aisi coordination kare jinko contract out kare ya kisi aur tarike se facilitate kare, unki coordination baharal wo kare. State should coordinate this provision, not directly provide services, but coordinate the provision of such services through different entities and facilitate them to do so. Now, they came up with this idea of three E's. That is economy, efficiency, and effectiveness. Kaji, ye teen cheezein jo hain, nihayat important hain. Aapne waste ko eradicate karna hai, taake economy ho sake. Aap resources zaya nahi karenge. Public administration bahut resources zaya karti hai. That has to stop. And you should be efficient, especially in the provision of your services. Provide services in a manner which is efficient, so nobody complains, so the feedback is good. Or, last but not least, effectiveness. कि आपने जो भी आपके resources हैं उनको इस तरीके से target करना है ताकि objective आपका achieve हो जाए. We can't make castles in the air. There have to be specific, doable objectives, and in accordance with the resources you have, and then you have to target those resources so that results are obtained. So effectiveness means that results have to be obtained. Like I mentioned before, that has our polio program been effective? No. Whatever the reasons. Now some new techniques and aspects of management were introduced at this stage. So the concept of performance appraisal was highlighted, that proper performance appraisal will definitely make a difference, and if the bureaucrats are assessed in a systematic manner, then the results would be better. It also emphasized on managerial autonomy. Let the management of a public sector entity have sufficient autonomy and not constant control by another agency or a superior to ensure good results. So there should be no undue interference in the management of public sector organizations. Isi tarah cost cutting pe importance diya gaya, wohi jo pehli E thi, economy, wastage nahi honi chahiye, cost cutting honi chahiye. Yani jahan aap 100 rupaye kharch kar rahe hain, shayad wohi kaam aap 90 mein kar sakte hain. Ye bada ek cost cutting ka bahut zabardast concept un dinon mein zor pakad gaya. Or of financial incentives, dijiyega. There's no harm in that. Give financial incentives to your workforce. Let them be motivated. So, bringing in some of these private sector things, that give financial incentives, give bonuses, have other ways of rewarding persons. So all these are borrowed from the private sector. Jaise private sector mein performance appraisal bahut sakht hota hai, isi tarah managers ko kafi autonomy hoti hai agar unhone perform karna hai. Autonomy zaruri hai, aur sath sath bahut emphasis hota hai ki cost kam kare, cost kam kare, cost kam kare. Aur jo acha kaam karta hai aur ya motivation ke liye acche khase financial incentives available hote hain. Output targets, yani ab aapne systematically chalna hai, aapne proper output targets har ek ko dene, phir unko appraise karna hai ki kahan tak targets mile, jaise private sector mein hote hai ki liye aapne itne revenues generate karne hai apni sale karke, ye aapka sales ka target hai. To isi tarah ke output targets aapko public sector mein dene honge. And innovation. This we have been saying many times, innovation. What is innovation? You've got to be creative in doing things. Find new ways of doing those things, which may do it speedier, or they may be less expensive. So you've got to use your imagination to innovate. You've got to be creative. तो ये बहुत एम्फेसिस था कि जितनी इनोवेशन हो सके पब्लिक सेक्टर में आप करें. सिर्फ प्राइवेट सेक्टर में जरूरत नहीं है इनोवेशन की. पब्लिक सेक्टर हैज टू इनोवेट एज मच एज पॉसिबल. एंड ऑफ कोर्स रिस्पॉन्सिवनेस, ये दिस हैज बीन द थीम ऑल अलोंग. हाउ रिस्पॉन्सिव इज द ब्यूरोक्रेसी, हाउ रिस्पॉन्सिव इज द पब्लिक सेक्टर, how responsive are the public administrators? ये हमेशा बहुत बड़ा question mark होता है कि responsive नहीं है ये लोग. तो बहुत emphasis new public management में responsiveness के aspect पे दिया गया कि please be responsive to the needs of the people you serve. Competence. Competence would be awarded. It would be rewarded. Tabhi to incentives ki baat hui. Ke we want competent people. To aap competent logon ko proper jagah pe lagayen, you will get good results. But accountability is a must. कि आपने साथ साथ उनको accountable भी रखना है. In other words, यानी आपने autonomy दे दी, managerial autonomy दे दी, लेकिन इसका ये मतलब नहीं कि accountability कम हो जाए. पूरा एक mechanism accountability का in place होना चाहिए. फिर जाके बात बनेगी. Competent लोग हों, उनकी accountability की जाए, performance appraisal सही तरीके से हो, उनको free hand दिया जाए या उनको managerial autonomy दी जाए, and that will make the public service, the public administration, a very different place. It will give it a very different shape. फिर market orientation की बात हुई. Again, very much borrowed from the private sector. लफ्ज भी market का इस्तेमाल हो रहा है, not service. Market orientation, look at your clients as a market, so that you get the kind of feedback that the private sector does for its products from its markets. तो आप एज अ मार्केट ट्रीट करेंगे उन लोगों को जिनको आप सर्व कर रहे हैं, और आपको पूरी उनके साथ ओरिएंटेशन करनी पड़ेगी. What kind of people they are, what are their demographics, what they think, what they need, to what extent you have been able to satisfy them. So this is market orientation. और एक चीज जो हमेशा प्राइवेट सेक्टर में बहुत इंपॉर्टेंस होता है जिसका, इज क्वालिटी इंप्रूवमेंट. देयर इज अ कॉन्स्टेंट प्रेशर in the private sector for quality improvement. There is no upper limit to quality improvement. So they say that keep on improving the quality. And this was borrowed by the new public management exponents for their paradigm. That okay, keep on improving the quality of your services. This goes without saying. Which client wouldn't want a better quality service? So, market orientation or no market orientation, you've got to keep on improving the quality of your services. One way could be contracting out. So a lot of emphasis was laid on the process of contracting out. Contracting out is a procedure wherein you bring in another agency to do the work which you were doing and pay them some amount for doing that work, in the hope that being a private sector entity, that entity would perform well. So contracting out was one of the favorite instruments propagated by the new public management exponents. For example, you can contract out waste disposal in a city, in a municipality. You can contract out toll collection on a road. You can contract out health services of sorts, you know. So contracting out was forwarded as one of the panaceas to the evils of unresponsiveness and low quality services of the public sector. Give them to other entities, let them perform. और ये बड़ा fashionable हो गया contracting out 1990s में. बहुत सी services अमरीका में और UK में US और UK में कॉन्ट्रैक्ट आउट कर दी गई थी. और फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी, डोंट बी रिजिड. ये वो बात आ गई कि आप वैल्यूज ला रहे हैं, इसलिए आपको फ्लेक्सिबल होना पड़ेगा. आप इम्पर्सनल नहीं रहेंगे इतने. आपको परहैप्स पूरी तरह हर जगह लॉ का कवर ना मिल सके. देर वुड बी न्यू इंसिडेंट्स, न्यू एग्जाम्पल्स, न्यू हैपनिंग्स विच आर नॉट कवर्ड बाय लॉ. सो द फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी इज रिक्वायर्ड देयर. बट इट्स नॉट ईजी फॉर अ पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर टू बी फ्लेक्सिबल, बिकॉज अ पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर वुड लाइक टू गो एग्जैक्टली अकॉर्डिंग टू लॉ. Now, to what extent that contributes towards serving the people or towards the economic development of the country is a question mark. However, the new public management said that be flexible. Then there was an emphasis on competition. Let there be competition within the public sector. And that is only possible if there is a choice. If there are a number of institutions, public sector institutions, which are providing a service, then only there can be competition. So, choice. You can go to institution A, B, or C for the same kind of service. Then you have choice. Also, information technology had by then become pretty important. And there was an emphasis to integrate information technology into the doings and management of the public sector. और हमें पता है कि information technology अब कई मुल्कों में बहुत ज्यादा integrate हो गई है गवर्नमेंट के कामों में. और घर बैठे हुए अब सिटीजन्स कई ऐसे काम कर लेते हैं जिनके लिए पहले उन्हें घंटों दफ्तरों में जाके बैठना पड़ता था काम करवाने के लिए. इन आवर ओन कंट्री, टेक द एग्जांपल ऑफ फाइलिंग ऑफ टैक्स रिटर्न्स, यू कैन डू देम इलेक्ट्रॉनिकली नाउ. सो ये वहां से इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी का सिलसिला चला कि जनाब इंटेग्रेट करें इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी को जो इतना फास्ट डेवलप कर रही थी 1990s में. लेकिन साथ ही फिर डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन की बात भी हुई कि यू गॉट टू डिसेंट्रलाइज पावर्स एंड फंक्शंस टू वेरियस levels and at different places, ताके local level पे लोगों को आसानी हो, services मिल सकें या relief मिल सकें या उनके problem solve हो सकें. And then there was this thing of downsizing which is still continuing, that government has become too big, the hierarchy chain is very long. Where you need 5 people, you have perhaps 15. So downsize, cut down the size of the government. ये हमारे यहाँ भी कई दफा practice हो चुकी है, कभी कभी फिर politicize हो जाती है कि government को छोटा करें, इतने लोगों की जरूरत नहीं है, आप overstaffed हैं. खासतौर पर अगर आप public corporations में देखेंगे तो बहुत ही ज्यादा overstaffed हैं. So ये डाउनसाइजिंग का जो कॉन्सेप्ट था ये मार्गरेट थैचर साहिबा और रेगन, प्रेसिडेंट रेगन ने भी इस्तेमाल किया और कई और मुल्कों ने भी इसको अडॉप्ट किया. और साथ साथ उन्होंने कहा कि सिर्फ डाउनसाइजिंग नहीं बल्कि जो एहलकार हैं हुकूमत के वो ब्यूरोक्रेसी के चक्रों में से निकले, یعنی وہ فارمل سسٹم اتنے زیادہ ٹائم لگانا مکھی پہ مکھی مارنا دیٹ شوڈ اسٹاپ سو ڈی بیوروکریٹائزیشن ہونی چاہیے میک پروسیجر سمپلر اسپینڈ لیس ٹائم آن تھنگس اور بیکم لائک دا پرائیویٹ سیکٹر لائک این انٹرپرینور آپ کام کریں لائک این انٹرپرینور ایز اف اٹس یور اون بزنس اٹس ناٹ somebody else's concern as if you are running your own business so be business like have the interest of the entity close to your heart and make sure that you do things in an innovative manner in an effective cost effective manner that you promote efficiency that you innovate as if it is your own business and you are the entrepreneur. So you are going to do everything possible for the success and good reputation of that business. Now since the new public management emphasized the public choice approach, let us have a look at it. It said, let us use a variety of organizations to provide different public goods and services and coordinate them. So if a number of utility companies are there providing the same service coordinated by the government, there'll be competition and there'll be a choice available with the public to do what they like. For example, right now we have a number of 3-4 telecom companies. So in the private sector, we have a choice which company to go to. But does that choice exist when it comes to the question of buying electricity or buying gas or buying water? I mean, water for the house? No. So the public choice approach is not at the moment relevant in Pakistan. But this was one of the underlying principles in the paradigm shift in the public administration. So summarizing, it emphasizes an anti-bureaucratic approach, diverse democratic decision making centers, institutional pluralism, economic logic. Yani aap jo kuch bhi kar rahe hain uske kuch sense to hona, economic sense to hona, ya aap aise hi paisa zaya karte jayenge, kharch karte jayenge. There should be economic sense to your program, there should be economic sense to your spending. Decentralization and popular participation. So we have looked at all these aspects before and also discussed them a little bit. So this is the summary of it all. In short, follow private sector practices. This followed Taylor's approach and is called neo-Taylorism. That instead of having special public sector management theories, let us follow the private sector practices as much as possible. What would be the goals? What would be the outcome? A catalytic government. A catalyst is something which makes a process go faster. So a catalytic government. Government going at speed. حکومت جو بہت سے کام جلدی جلدی کر رہی ہے عوام کی بینیفٹ کے لیے, دیٹ از اے کیٹالیٹک گورنمنٹ. سو اٹ واز انویسڈ دیٹ اف یو introduce private sector techniques as much as possible, you will have a catalytic government. New public management envisaged the government to be something in action and motion all the time, speedily meeting the demands of the people and providing quality services. So catalytic government ہونا آسان نہیں ہے. ہمارے ہاں تو ایڈ ہاک گورنمنٹ ہے, فائر فائٹنگ والی گورنمنٹ ہے, یہ بھی بہت بزی رہتی ہے, کیٹالیٹک ہے ان دیٹ سینس. بٹ ا ریئل کیٹالیٹک گورنمنٹ از ناٹ دا فائر فائٹنگ گورنمنٹ, ایڈ ہاک گورنمنٹ نہیں, وہ پالیسیز پہ بیسڈ ہے, وہ کوالٹی سروس پروویژن پہ بیسڈ ہے بٹ اسپیڈی. دین کمیونٹی اون گورنمنٹ, this is very much possible at the local level. کہ بجائے اس کے کہ کوئی دور ادارہ ہے جو آپ کے لیے ڈیسیژنس لے رہا ہے, آپ نے کمیونٹی لیول پہ ایسا ایک سیٹ اپ کر لیا اور وہ پارٹیسپیٹری بھی ہو سکتا ہے, دیٹ یو آر گیٹنگ یور سروسز اینڈ یو ہیو سم کنٹرول اوور دوز سروسز. جب کمیونٹی انوالو ہو جاتی ہے تو کمیونٹی کا کنٹرول بھی ساتھ آ جاتا ہے, وچ از ناٹ اے نیگیٹو تھنگ, اٹ از ویری مچ اے پازیٹو تھنگ. کمپیٹیٹو گورنمنٹ, ہاؤ کین اے گورنمنٹ بی کمپیٹیٹو؟ اے گورنمنٹ کین بی کمپیٹیٹو اف دیر از اے پلورلسٹک ارینجمنٹ آف انسٹیٹیوشنز ٹو پرووائڈ گڈز اینڈ سروسز. A government can be competitive if it has borrowed enough private sector practices. کیونکہ جو بھی private sector practices ہیں ان کا base competitiveness اور profit maximization ہے. یہ دو چیزیں سامنے رکھ کر ہی وہ practices introduce کی گئی ہیں. So if we are going to borrow those practices, we will qualified to be called a competitive government. Or agar we have provided more than one way or more than one institution to do a thing or provide a service, then definitely that competitiveness can be judged. And a mission driven government, yani aap wo kaam jo hai jazbe se kar rahe hain, aapka ek mission hai, آپ نے لوگوں کی خدمت کرنی ہے, آپ نے کوالٹی سروسز دینی ہے, اگر آپ یہ سب کچھ جذبے کے ساتھ کر رہے ہیں تو یو کین کوالیفائی ٹو بی کالڈ اے مشن ڈریون گورنمنٹ. سو دا نیو پبلک مینجمنٹ انویسٹڈ دا گورنمنٹ ٹو بیکم اے کیٹالیٹک کمپیٹیٹو اینڈ اے مشن ڈریون گورنمنٹ. اور اس کا نتیجہ کیا ہوگا؟ اگر اس قسم کی گورنمنٹ آ جاتی ہے تو ریزلٹس تو اچیو کرے گی. اگر آپ اتنا افیکٹو اور افیشینٹ گورنمنٹ کو بنا دیتے ہیں, اتنا کمپیٹیٹو بنا دیتے ہیں, اتنا اسپیڈی بنا دیتے ہیں, تو ظاہر ہے ریزلٹس تو ملیں گے. سو یو کین کال اٹ اے ریزلٹ اورینٹڈ گورنمنٹ. نیچرلی آل دس ول لیڈ ٹو a results oriented government. اس کے بعد وہی بات جو ہم نے پہلے کی تھی, a customer driven government. اس نے اپنے کلائنٹ کا خیال رکھنا ہے, اس نے اپنے کلائنٹ پہ نظر رکھنی ہے, اس نے اپنے کلائنٹ سے فیڈ بیک لینی ہے, اس نے بالکل کلائنٹ کو ایسے ہی ٹریٹ کرنا ہے جیسے ایک پرائیویٹ سیکٹر میں ایک ٹیلی کام یا بینک والا اپنے کلائنٹ کو یا کسٹمر کو کنسیڈر کرتا ہے. سو اٹ ہیز ٹو بی کسٹمر ڈریون گورنمنٹ, یعنی جو کسٹمر کہے گا وہی ہونا چاہیے. اینڈ این انٹرپرائزنگ گورنمنٹ, not a status quo government. An enterprising government would be one which goes out of the way to improve, to bring about new things, to innovate. So, this goes with the spirit of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurial government would be an enterprising government. Ek jo entrepreneur hota hai, wo apne business ko phailata hai, expand karta hai, behtar karta hai. So, an enterprising government would also do the same. An anticipatory government. Now, I mentioned ad hoc or firefighting. Anticipatory government bilkul uska ult hai. Aap intezaar nahi karte ki ek waqia ya sanya ho aur phir hum jaake uska kuch madawa kare. No. Anticipatory government pehle se calculate karti hai kya ho sakta hai aur agar hua to uski contingency planning maine kar li hai, maine react kaise karna hai. So an anticipatory government is one which is very much based on planning, on contingency planning also, preparing for all kinds of things which might happen, preparing for all that may go wrong. That is an anticipatory government. A decentralized government, we already talked about that. That when the government comes closer to the people, the powers are decentralized to a lower level. Perhaps to the community level would be the best. Then a great change in the lives of the beneficiaries, of the clients, of the people at large occurs. So, decentralized government was one of the goals of the new public management. And of course, we can't leave the market out, because now we have borrowed everything from the private sector. So now we can label our government also as a market-oriented government. And that is almost the same as the customer-driven government or the service-providing government. So, the government, the public administration has to keep an eye on its market, and its market are the people of the whole country, and it has to be oriented towards them, towards their needs, towards their aspirations, and fulfill their expectations. That would be a market-oriented government. So what would be the impact of all this? This is very interesting. What has been the impact of the new public management? ये सब जो बातें हुई, जो concepts पेश किए गए, उनका aftermath क्या था? उसकी वजह से क्या-क्या सामने आया, मार्ज़े वजूद में आया और हुआ? Creation of autonomous public organizations. यानी public sector में organizations ऐसी create की गई, जिनको काफी autonomy थी, और उन्होंने अपनी services provide करनी शुरू कर दी. ये किस हद तक successful रहा वो अलग बात. फिर reduction in the size of government. There was a pressure on governments. कि जी small government, small government, small government. Government को reduce करें. तो एक ये trend सामने आया. Reducing the size of government. और फिर corporatization of government organizations. Yani government organizations jo pehle bilkul government ki tarah chal rahi thi. Masalan, let us say postal department tha, agar aapne usko postal corporation bana diya to aapne government ki ek activity ko corporatize kar diya. So impact uska ek ye hua in sab is philosophy ka, is paradigm shift ka, ke kai activities aur organizations jo wo activities kar rahi thi unko corporate basis par chalana shuru kar diya gaya. Lekin ek aur jo negative impact hua uska wo ye ki jab aapne kaha ke kam kharch karo, economy chahiye, to sabse pehle cut welfare expenditure par laga. Dusra budget bhi reduce hua, overall budget reduction hui, but usme sabse zyada suffer kisne kiya? Welfare expenditure mein. And this goes, however, in keeping with the public, with the private sector philosophy. Yeh hum kha kyun welfare pe expenditure karein agar uska koi return nahi hai. But if you are a welfare state, agar aapne England mein kaha hua hai ki aap welfare state hain aur aap phir cut down karte hain a lot on the welfare expenditure, so that is at odds. Ek aur bada important jo iska fallout tha, reforming of the civil service structures. Ye kai mulkon mein hua, Pakistan mein bhi. 1973 mein aapko yaad hoga bahut badi reforms aaye. Uske baad phir performance evaluation and measurement ki techniques, they also underwent a great change, and new private sector techniques were introduced by many governments, not in Pakistan, but many governments introduced private sector techniques where the peers also review you, and you have a right to challenge what has been written about you, etc. So new performance evaluation and measurement techniques came in, borrowed from the private sector. Privatization of public undertakings. This happened on a large scale in many countries, even in Pakistan. We have had these successive cycles of privatization, especially with a particular government which has this philosophy of promoting business-like government, believes in privatizing assets of the government. So this happened in many countries and in a big way, and many people didn't like it. And of course, decentralization to the lower levels, to the lower rungs of authority took place. Like if 100 powers were being exercised by the topmost person in the hierarchy in the public sector, maybe half of them went to people lower down so that they could provide that service or that relief to the common man at a lower level, at the grassroots level. So another impact of this paradigm shift was that authority, administrative authority that is, got decentralized to lower levels in the government. And we discussed this one before. A lot of contracting out of services to private agencies took place. We mentioned a number of activities which can be or have been contracted out in various countries, including Pakistan. And this started all with the emphasis on the concepts which were put forward by the new public management. This also promoted transparency in administration, very important. The last thing which bureaucrats want is more and more transparency. So this movement pushed the governments to become more open, to be more transparent. Jo wo kaam karti hain, kaise karti hain, kyun karti hain, kis tarike se hua, kisko kyun theka mila, wagaira wagaira. So this was an important fallout. also encouraging citizens' participation in administration. یہ جب سب باتیں ہو رہی تھیں اور ڈسکشنز ہو رہے تھے اور نیا پیراڈائم شفٹ ویسٹ میں ڈیولپ ہو رہا تھا تو اس نے لوگوں کو انکریج کیا یار ہم حکومت کے ساتھ پارٹیسپیٹ کرتے ہیں ایڈمنسٹریشن میں آفٹر آل اٹ از فار آور اون گڈ سو دس ڈیڈ ہیپن مور اینڈ مور پارٹیسپیشن بائی سٹیزنز ان دی ایڈمنسٹریشن اور پھر مختلف طریقوں سے آگے باتیں چلتی رہیں کچھ کنٹریز نے سٹیزنز چارٹرز ایوالو کیے جس میں یہ کہا گیا کہ جی یہ رائٹس ہیں سٹیزنز کی وز اوی پبلک ایڈمنسٹریشن ا کائنڈ آف اے سوشل کانٹریکٹ بٹوین پبلک ایڈمنسٹریشن اتھارٹیز اینڈ دا سٹیزنز آف دا کنٹری اینڈ سملر ایکٹیویٹیز came up and I think some of these impacts which we have considered which came about because of the new public management and the paradigm shift which occurred in the 80s have in a big way contributed towards better governance. Thank you.